Shown on this map of the Upper Rhine Graben and the surrounding regions are earthquakes that have happened in these areas since 1982. Large circles indicate strong quakes and small circles weak ones. The Upper Rhine Graben is marked in white. What do you notice? First of all, it appears that there are more small quakes than big ones. Secondly, the seismicity has quite a random distribution over time. Thirdly, small clusters of aftershocks sometimes occur around larger earthquakes. The statistical description of these three phenomena is an important foundation for being able to estimate seismic hazards. Hello and welcome. In this video, you will become acquainted with the three most important statistical distribution models used in seismology. You will learn about their significance for estimating seismic hazards and learn how you can assess datasets specifically with regard to these statistical properties. As in the introduction, I would like to show you these distributions using the earthquakes in the Upper Rhine Graben and the surrounding regions. Firstly, I will be introducing the Poisson distribution, which describes the fact that earthquakes occur independently in time. That means that they have a random distribution. This is an important prerequisite for many seismic hazard analyses and greatly simplifies more advanced calculations. To do so, I will now transfer the earthquakes from the Upper Rhine Graben from the map we saw earlier to a diagram, and at the same time limit myself to quakes with a magnitude greater than 2. We will also ignore foreshocks and aftershocks. The diagram now shows how many main shocks occurred in each 2-month time window. Once again, it appears that the occurrence over time is random. In order to confirm this impression, we test the data for Poisson distribution and ask how often do 5 events occur every 2 months and how often 4, 3, 2, 1 or none at all. This is what this histogram shows, which indicates the number of time windows n and the number of the corresponding quakes k in it. Hence, we see that no main shock occurred in 43 time windows and exactly 1 in 57 of them. A Poisson distribution is considered to exist when n equals n0 times lambda to the power of k divided by k factorial times e to the power of negative lambda. n0 is the number of time windows. In this case, 31 years times 6 corresponding windows, giving 182. Lambda is easy to calculate. For the first bar, k equals 0. Hence, the following applies. N of k equals 0 equals n0 times e to the power of negative lambda. If we solve for lambda, we get lambda equals minus the natural logarithm of n of 0 divided by n0 equals negative ln of 43 divided by 182 equals 1.44. With this, we can calculate the theoretical Poisson distribution according to the formula. This is what it looks like, and is very close to the observed distribution of main shocks in the Upper Rhine Graben. Hence, the main shocks follow a Poisson distribution and are therefore independent in time. This means that the seismic history is irrelevant when determining if an earthquake will happen or not. If I had not filtered out the fore and aftershocks, this would have been not the case after all. By definition, they are dependent on the occurrence of the main shock. The second distribution that I will be introducing was first described by Gutenberg and Richter. For California, these two scientists found the mathematical description for the fact that smaller quakes occur more frequently than large ones. As you will soon see, the same observation can also be made in the Upper Rhine Graben. Qualitatively, this is already apparent on the map. First, let me show the magnitude distribution over time. We see that only 2 earthquakes with a magnitude equal or greater than 4 have occurred since 1982. By the way, the mean value is 2.35. We will need it in the next step. As we did previously, we now create a histogram to investigate the distribution in more detail. For this purpose, we count how often each year earthquakes occur, which have a magnitude greater than a certain value, and enter this in a histogram. We speak of a Gutenberg-Richter distribution, when the data forms a line in the logarithmic plot, which is the case here. The corresponding formula for this is the decadic logarithm of the number of quakes n equals a minus b times the magnitude m. Hence, the b value is the negative line gradient and can be calculated using a maximum likelihood estimation. B equals the decadic logarithm of e divided by the mean magnitude m bar minus the smallest completely used magnitude mc. Substituting the mean magnitude 2.35 from before and mc equals 1.95, we get a b value of 1.09. This is very close to a value of 1, which in this case says that 10 times less magnitude 3 quakes occur than magnitude 2 quakes. The A value is calculated by substituting the number of quakes greater than MC, and in the example gives 3.07. This allows for a simplified estimation of how frequent a strong quake of magnitude 5 would be. Log n equals 3.07 minus 1.09 times 5 equals minus 2.38. That means n equals 0.004 per year or once every 250 years. The Gutenberg-Richter distribution is also valid globally. The number of earthquakes falls logarithmically with increasing magnitude worldwide with b value of 1. This distribution is useful in order to make predictions about the probability of strong quakes, which have not yet or have only been observed in historic times. To do so, we extrapolate the estimate up to a maximum expected magnitude and beyond and read off its frequency. The third distribution I would like to introduce to you is Omori's law. It describes the decrease in the number of aftershocks over time. For this purpose, we will focus on the earthquake of Rhombergvillers in the Vosges Mountains on February 22, 2003, which had a magnitude of 5.4 and resulted in minor damage to buildings. Shown here is the spatial distribution of the aftershocks. They form a cluster around the main shock. The depiction of the number of quakes in two-day intervals shows the decline in earthquake activity. Omori's law specifically adapts this decline. In order to use it formally, we rotate the coordinate system and multiply the number of days by the number of aftershocks. The most commonly used form of Omori's law is rate of occurrence n equals c divided by k plus time t to the power of p. The parameter p is typically assumed to be approximately 1, such that the equation is simplified and only the values of c and k need to be determined. We now multiply by k plus t and obtain nk plus nt equals c. Rearranging the equation gives nt equals c minus nk. This now corresponds exactly to our diagram, number of aftershocks n times days t on the y-axis and n on the x-axis. If we now fit the distribution of points to a line, the gradient of the line equals minus k and the intercept equals c. K is therefore approximately minus 1.4 and c equals 40. If we substitute that into Omori's law, we can now more or less adapt the original data of the previous diagram. Hence, Omori's law provides information about the decline in the number of aftershocks after a large earthquake. If, additionally, we wish to make predictions regarding the expected magnitudes, we can utilize the empirical observation that the largest aftershock magnitude is smaller than that of the main shock by around 1. If we then also assume a Gutenberg-Richter distribution for the aftershocks, it is possible to roughly estimate the expected aftershock magnitudes. You have now learned about the three most important distribution models in seismology. First, the Poisson distribution, which describes the random distribution of main shocks that is independent over time. Secondly, the Gutenberg-Richter distribution, which indicates the ratio between the frequency of strong versus weak quakes. The decrease here is logarithmic. And third of all, Omori's law, which shows how the number of aftershocks decreases over time or how long after a strong earthquake aftershocks can still be expected. In seismic hazard assessment, these three concepts are often combined with each other in order to be able to make predictions regarding the probability of future earthquakes.
Thank you.